Our class outline today is week 5. We're going to be talking about theology of fall and redemption. That's not fall, the season fall. John's camera on?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You were talking about the fall of humanity, the entrance of sin and death into the world. But before we get into details of that, we need to talk a little bit about what does it mean to be human. I could have dealt with this as part of the creation class 2 weeks ago. But I wanted to deal with it immediately as we get into a discussion of what the fall is. When we talk about what it means to be human from a theological point of view, we're actually talking about what's known as theological anthropology. Theological anthropology, well, most of you probably, if you took college classes in sociology or anthropology means the study of humanity. But theological anthropology, and sometimes in our context it's called Christian anthropology, is the study of humanity as relates to God, or in the context of a belief in God. Theological anthropology is the study of what it means to be human in light of our belief in God, and especially in the way in which human beings are made in the image of God. That's theological anthropology, and it's critical for us to have some concept of that as we move into a discussion about the fall. Particularly, Genesis 1, 26 and 27 is the scripture that gives us our basis for a theological anthropology. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image and our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. So it is our belief in theological anthropology that in the creation, God made humanity, male and female, in his image. And in doing so, he established humanity as the highest point, the apex of creation. The part of creation that specifically reflected his actual personhood, if you will. So, as I said, I think a clear theological anthropology is necessary for us to make sense of the existence of sin and evil, and to make sense of the doctrines we have, or theologies we have, of the fall, and then of redemption. We need to have a conception of a theological anthropology. And I think we can say that every culture that has ever been discovered or has existed, as far as we know, has had some sense that there is something wrong with humanity, that there is something broken in us. The grief that we feel, the pain we experience, the betrayal, the inability to communicate, the inability to relate well with one another, all of those, every culture has had some sense in which there is something wrong or broken with humanity. And our belief as Christians is that humanity was exalted by God, made in the image of God, and was intended for a life which reflected God's perfection. But we fell from that relationship by disobedience, by betrayal to God's good faith in us, and that gives us a reasonable explanation or understanding for what is wrong with humanity. So our theological anthropology, that we were made in the image of God, for relationship with God, but that we fell from that relationship, is the basis for our understanding what is wrong with humanity. And that's why a doctrine of the fall is critical for an understanding, as is doctrine of creation, for understanding theological anthropology, for understanding the nature of human beings. Does that make sense? All right, so what was God's intention in creating humanity as sort of a first aspect of theological anthropology? We've said that God made us, humanity, in his own image, and what was his purpose in doing so? First, we talked about this under creation. God made us for his glory. All of creation is a reflection of God's glory, of his intention to manifest his own perfection and his might and his glory in the created world. And nowhere is that more true than in the image that was made in, or the creature that was made in his image, which is humanity. Genesis 1:31, God saw all that he had made, and it was very good, and there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. God made all of creation, with humanity as the apex, the highest point of that creation, as a creative act to express his own creativity, to express his own nature, to give himself glory through the beauty of the created thing. When we talked about creation earlier, I said any of you who do painting or sculpture or woodworking or furniture making, anything else that you might do, you do it because it gives you a sense of satisfaction, that you can, something apart from yourself, but that you are responsible for making, gives you satisfaction. And in God's case, not only satisfaction, but glory. So he made us as the highest point of the creation that gives him glory. A second reason that God made humanity is for fellowship. Genesis 3:8-9 said, "Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden at the end of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden, but the Lord God called to man, 'Where are you?'" This passage is after the commission of sin, but before the discussion between Adam and Eve and God about it, but it reflects the nature of the kind of interaction that God was having with Adam and Eve at that time. The image of God walking in the garden in the cool of the day for the purpose of meeting with and having fellowship with his creature. That's why God made humanity in his image, so that we could relate to him. It's very difficult for us to relate to a creature, at least on a face-to-face kind of intimate basis, who is not like us. This is also the reason, by the way, that God made Eve, because it was determined that in the whole animal kingdom, there really was no appropriate partner or helpmate or companion that could be an equal to Adam. And so God made Eve. That's why we have male and female. But in its whole, God made humanity in order to have fellowship, in order to be in relationship with. And the third reason is to care for creation. God made Adam and Eve to take care of creation, give them precedence over all creation. I'm sorry this is a little bit low. You can't quite see the bottom of that. Let me see if I can... I'll probably make a disaster of this because this thing is so sensitive. That's a little better. Genesis 1:28 says, "God blessed them," that's Adam and Eve, "and said to them, 'Be fruitful, increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground.'" And then in Genesis 2:8-15, "Now the Lord God had planted a garden in the east in Eden, and there he put the man he had formed. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it." Now, work today is hard. It's drudgery. Most people, they say that all surveys say the majority of people don't like the job that they do. They don't like their work. Work has become synonymous with something very negative. And yet, the original work was not drudgery. It was not this toil that came after the fall. But it was something that was satisfying. It was something that Adam and Eve were intended to get fulfillment out of, to find satisfaction. How many of you all garden? How many of you have a garden? Okay, a few of you. And do you do it because you need the food? No, you do it because it's satisfying to see things grow. That, you know, multiply that by any number of times, and that's the kind of motivation that Adam and Eve would have had, because God made them for the purpose of tending the garden and caring really for all of creation, the garden being the representative part of it. But you'll remember that Adam was given responsibility for naming all of the animals. And in the Old Testament times and any ancient culture, we know that the giving of a name was a very powerful thing. That's why people's names often get changed in the Bible when a major event happens, because a name is really significant. The knowing of a name, and even more so the giving of a name, is a sign of authority. And so for Adam to have been given responsibility to name all of the creatures in creation would have suggested that he had authority over them, that he was responsible for them, if you will. So these three reasons why God created humanity as part of our theological anthropology is for his glory, for fellowship with him, that's why we were made in his image, and to care for creation. So that kind of gives us a foundation for the theological anthropology. In what way were we made in the image of God? This list could be quite a bit longer, but I'll give you a few ways in which we were made in the image of God. How is it that we are like God that no other creature is? First, we are self-aware. That means that we have an awareness of ourselves as distinct from all other creatures. We recognize ourselves as an individual. Most animals don't seem to have that same sense. Most animals see themselves as part of a pack or as a larger sense of without a particular individuality or self-awareness. We are spiritually aware. We recognize spiritual needs. I love my dogs. We think they're people. We call them our dog-faced children. But I don't have any sense ever, as close as we are to them, that they have any spiritual awareness. You know, they do not have a sense of a higher calling to anything beyond sleeping in treats, pretty much. Some people seem like that, but we as human beings, we do have a spiritual awareness. We have a moral capacity. We can know right from wrong. Part of that, knowing good from evil, is part of the result of the fall, but the idea of knowing right from wrong is inherent in humanity and in no other creature. We have volition, meaning we have self-determination. We can make decisions for ourselves. We can control our environment, in other words, in a way that no other creature really quite can. We are communicative. We have the ability to communicate at various levels beyond, you know, I want a treat or I want to go sleep now. We have the ability to communicate much more subtle kinds of feelings and sensitivities and messages than any other kind of animal. It doesn't mean animals can't communicate at all, but they communicate in very crude sense compared to humanity. We are creative. We make things. In fact, we are driven to make things. Not in the same way God did. God made everything ex nihilo, out of nothing. But human beings have a natural inclination toward making stuff, to be creative, to decorate, to appreciate beauty. That's part of creativity that does not exist in any other animal. We are rational. We have the ability to use our reason and make rational decisions. Trust me, I know our dogs are not rational. No way. And we are trichotomous. Some theologians would argue with me on this one, but I believe that the indication is strong that we are trichotomous. What does that mean? That means we have three parts. Those of you who have been in the new members class, or I may have even mentioned this previously in one of the classes in here, when we say God made us in His image, God is one God, the Godhead, who is three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. When we were made in God's image, we too were given three parts. I have a mind, which is the controlling side. I have a spirit, which is internal, which is affected by things that my mind can't really conceive of. Loyalty and honor and love, those are things that are more the heart rather than the head. Those are internal to our spirit. And then I have a physical body. In the same way, God is, you know, the controlling mentality, if you will, which is God the Father. There is the spirit, which deals with things like honor and love and conviction and comfort, which is the Holy Spirit. And then there was the physical incarnation of the Son, which is the body. So I believe that human beings are trichotomous of three parts, and that is one of the ways in which we're made in the image of God. In fact, to me, that's the best way to understand how God could be one God with three persons, because I'm one being, you're one being, but you have three very distinct parts. And in human beings, for instance, it's even possible for our minds to go away and our bodies to still survive, or our bodies to stop functioning in the way they're supposed to, and our minds still to be alert. There is a clear distinction in there. Now, death affects all three of those, but we are trichotomous as one aspect of the way in which we are in the image of God. Any other comments on that in terms of ways in which you think of that we are in the image of God? Anything you think I've missed? I put this down as a quick list of the things that I believe are obvious. Bill?
Normally they refer to the soul as including the mind, the emotions, etc.
Well, the soul or the spirit, again, that's sort of how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. Some theologians argue that there's a difference between the soul and the spirit. As far as I'm concerned, I use the words synonymously. I mean, I use them interchangeably. So when I said spirit, I mean the soul, the internal part of us, okay? But there is that part that is neither physical nor mental, that is internal to us, and is a very real essence, whether you call it soul or spirit, or whether you're one of the theologians that wants to argue that they're not the same thing. Okay? So what is the fall? The fall is the event, not if the event, but the fall is the event recorded in Genesis 3, which has been called the most tragic chapter in the Bible, the story of the fall, in which Adam and Eve, God's first created persons and the progenitors of all humanity, they were our first ancestors. Now, whether you believe literally in Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, or you believe that there was a point at which God created two primate beings with all of those capabilities in his image doesn't matter for the truth of what we're getting at here right now, okay? I could argue either direction with you. The point is, we believe God created. He created humanity, whether he did it all at once or over a long period of time. He gave these creatures, which we know as Adam and Eve, the ability to recognize him as the creator in whose image they were made. So, and that they were the progenitors, the initial ancestors for all of us who followed. That those two betrayed the trust and love that God had given them by violating the only restriction that had been placed upon them to not eat the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God put them in the garden, gave them free run of everything. They had no restrictions, no obligations or responsibilities that were not satisfying. They were not things they didn't want to do. And yet they violated the only one condition that God gave them. By thus defying and disobeying God, the perfect relationship with God was broken, and Adam and Eve received their just punishment for their betrayal. And here's what the results of the fall were in Christian theology. First, human self-awareness. Again, we said to be self-aware is one of the things, ways in which we were made in the image of God. Self-awareness became self-consciousness, which involves shame and guilt. The first thing that Adam and Eve did after Eve convinced Adam to eat of the apple was they realized they were naked and they made coverings for themselves. They felt shame when previously they had not. Second thing is their reason was perverted. People became self-deluded. This was actually part of the decision-making process when Eve decided that the, you know, eating this apple will make me like God. And then she convinced Adam very quickly of exactly the same thing. So the self-delusion that I am greater than I really am. Third is insecurity, which is reflected in blame and accusation. People who cannot take responsibility for their own actions or their own circumstances, but have to find somebody else to blame. You will remember that in the fall, when God shows up and says, "Who told you you were naked?" Adam says, "This woman did it, and she's the woman you gave me, God." So Adam manages to blame two people. Well, two beings. First Eve, and then God. All right. So the idea of blame and accusation, insecurity, entered into the world at that point. Also, at that point, all human faculties and judgment became clouded. The inability to see clearly, which we recognize in humanity today. Our human beings as a whole have pretty poor judgment about stuff. Just look at the condition of the world today. That was the point at which pain and death entered into the world for all creation, not just for Adam and Eve, but for all creation. We're going to talk later about Adam as the federal head. Adam was not only the ancestor for all of humanity, but he was the sort of elected head, elected by God, to be the person responsible for all of creation. And because of his fall, and by the way, Adam was more at fault than Eve was, even though people... You know, I read articles that say, well, you know, the Christian doctrine of the fall is misogynist because they blame Eve for everything. Actually, God blamed Adam for it because God had specifically spoken directly to Adam and said, here's what you're to do and not to do. Adam communicated to Eve. Eve fell victim to the temptation of the devil. But when she then offered the apple, which Adam knew he wasn't supposed to eat, Adam still had the words of God ringing in his ears practically. And yet he violated that trust. So Adam is more responsible than Eve is, even though she's the one that Adam tried to blame. Okay? So pain and death entered into the world for all creation. The very first thing that happens after Adam and Eve, God tells them what their punishments are going to be. And there are punishments. There are consequences for sin. Then he gives them animal skins for clothing, which means that death entered into the world for the animal world as well right then. Then, for all humanity, this marked the point not only of physical death, but of the potential for spiritual death long-term, entered into the world for the very first time. That's the nature of the fall, and that's why we talk about fall and redemption together. Redemption is what then gets done about the potential for spiritual death. Okay. Any questions about that? So the story of the fall is how God created and exalted humanity, and then by our own judgment, poor judgment, our own betrayal of the faith God had put in us, and our own disobedience, we fall from the relationship we were intended for, which is a relationship of fellowship with God, for which we were made. That is the nature of the fall. This is actually the verse, Genesis 3. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from the tree of the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden." You notice that Satan twists God's word. Did God really say? So first he's questioning whether or not we understand correctly what God said. And then he said, "Did God really say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?" Which is not what God said. And Satan knew that's not what God said. The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." You will not surely die. And now Satan, his next trick, is he questions whether God will really do what he said he was going to do, or whether the consequences are really what Eve knew very well. She just told him, but Satan gets her to question whether that really will be the consequence. "You will not surely die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God." There it is. There's the hook. "You will be like God, knowing good and evil." Why would you want to know evil if you didn't? Right? But the temptation to be like God. "When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it." No questions. "Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked, so they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves." This is the fall. Mary.
How would they know what death and evil were?
Well, apparently, the fact that Eve said, "You will surely die," there must have been some explanation that God gave to Adam that's not communicated to us in terms of his instruction to them earlier. But God gives the instruction to Adam before Eve is even created. That Eve is created, and apparently, when Adam was giving her the tour of the place, he said, "Okay, here are the ground rules. Pretty simple. This is ours. God has said that we take care of it, it's ours, we can enjoy it, we can eat all of the fruit trees, the animals are all really friendly, I'll tell you what their names are. There's only one thing that we can't do, we can't eat from that tree, because if we do, then God said we will die." And it may be there was, I'm not really sure what that means, but I get the idea it's a bad thing. So don't eat from that tree. Okay? I'm extrapolating here, we don't have the details, but however it happened, the story we have, the thing that Eve says, communicated to us, that God had said the consequences will be very severe if you violate my rules. Other than that, we're good. But if you do this one thing, then there's going to be serious problems. All right, whether they knew what death even meant yet or not, because there was no death had not yet entered into the world. Okay? Anything else? Michael.
Isn't it true that we have no idea how much time elapsed in which the relationship was perfect before Adam or mankind fell into this?
That's absolutely true. The passages in Scripture are immediately juxtaposed. We have Adam created and told about the garden, and then Eve is created as a helpmate after Adam names all the animals. And then, that's chapter 2. Chapter 1 is the broad stroke creation of the whole universe, all creation. Part of which is a sort of an abbreviated comment that on the sixth day God made humanity. Then chapter 2 is a focusing in. Some people have said, well, there's two different creation accounts. There's not. The second chapter of Genesis is a focusing in on what's the most important thing that happened in the first day, and that is more detail is given about the creation of humanity. The apex, the highest level of God's creation. It's like if I were to describe to you, you know, the history of extranjeros coming to Lake Chapala. And I did it in real broad strokes. I said, and then I said, now the most important part of this was this time period in which, you know, there was the biggest influx of people. And I go back and I give you more detail about what happened during that time period. That's what happens between Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. Genesis 2 is a focusing in of more detail about the most important part, about the broad history of creation. Then, that, you know, that ends with the naming of the animals and God deciding that there was not an appropriate helpmate found amongst all those animals for Adam. And so Eve was created, end of chapter 2, and then we get to chapter 3, and it starts right here. We don't know how much time elapsed in that period of time. We don't even know exactly if this is a literal story or a metaphorical story. But we know that whether it is literal or metaphorical, it represents actual events. That's what we believe. That is the nature of the Christian faith. It represents real things that happen. There is nothing wrong with metaphorically getting to the real meat of something. I think I said to you before, some people think that things are either facts or they are myths. Because we have the wrong definition nowadays of what a myth is. We think a myth is anything that's not true. That's not the definition of a myth. A myth is a story that has a higher, more important point that's being made, whether it's historic, whether it's actual fact or not. Okay? A myth can be factual, a myth can be fictional, but in either case, a myth is something that has a higher point to be made. In that regard, the garden story is a myth, which does not mean that it's not true. I mean, it could literally be the case. If that's how God literally wanted to do it and record it for us, then he could do that. Or it could be a metaphorical representation or myth that about the truth of what happened. But God was there. God made all that is. God made us in his image. The particulars of how all that worked out, someday we'll have more details on. Is that fair? We have to have a little humility there. Again, it's not those who declare unequivocally that they know exactly what happened or didn't happen in the first three chapters of Genesis in terms of fact, historical event, da-da-da. Either side, either it can't be, it's not possible, or it has to be exactly literally like that. Either one of those are prideful statements. It's saying that, you know, I have to be able to figure it out with my own mind and make my judgment about it, or else I'm not willing to accept that God is at work, okay? Or that God doesn't exist, in the case of the liberals. I think we have to take this for what it means and the value of it and have some humility about it. Fair? Okay? So, let's talk about now, what is sin? Well, actually, I want to do one other thing first. Let me talk for a few minutes about the kind of development of the doctrine of the fall. And the reason I say development of the doctrine of the fall is that even though this passage is in Genesis, the Hebrew people did not really have a doctrine of the fall. They didn't have a theological anthropology which identified that this event in Genesis explains so much of the nature of humanity right now. The Jewish theologians, those especially the ancient Jewish theologians, had a very different understanding of what happened as a result of this and where that takes us. In fact, the concept of the fall in Hebrew scriptures really didn't get articulated until the intertestamental period, which would have been the 2nd century B.C. to the first century, into the 1st century A.D. In that, the apocalyptic Jewish text of Enoch creates a story which is based upon Genesis 6. You know the story about the Nephilim? And the Nephilim came down, and they married the daughters of men, and they bore children who were the great men of old, and all that. That's a completely mysterious passage. The general understanding is that the Nephilim represent angelic beings who came down and were able somehow to intermarry with human beings. We don't really know. I mean, that's one of those mysteries. It's like on the list. When we get there, we're going to have to say, okay, explain Genesis 6 to us. What's the Nephilim thing? But Enoch says that humankind was created immortal, pure, and righteous, but because of the demons, the fallen angels, the head of which was Azazel and the Nephilim got involved with human beings, and because of that intermarriage and that bearing of children, that's where unrighteousness and death and all that came in, because human beings got mixed up with fallen angels. We don't believe that's the case now, but that's the, I only give you that, because historically, the first time that the Jewish theology really made any effort to try to explain what's wrong with humanity, even given the fact that this is in the Tanakh, the Old Testament, was not until like the 2nd century B.C. And it was a mythological thing having to do with that mysterious passage in Genesis 6. So the Jews have never had the same kind of understanding either of the fall or of original sin that we have. I'm going to talk about sin in a few minutes, and when I do, I'll talk broadly first, then I'll talk about the Jewish conception of sin, because this is a class on the Old Testament. because we're talking about the fall and sin and redemption, I have to bring a little bit of the New Testament into this one, but I'm going to focus mostly on the Old Testament so that you get a sense of that. Now, let me move on now to what is sin? I think a good definition for sin is anything in a creature, a creature meaning some, you know, a being that was made by the Creator. That's what creature means. Anything in a creature which does not express or which is contrary to the holy character of the Creator. Anything in us which is not what God wants to be in us is a sin. Anything we think or say or feel or do that is contrary to the will of God is a sin. That's pretty straightforward. Now, I want to make a distinction here between sin with a capital S, and what I'm about to tell you is one of the most fundamental misunderstandings people have about the nature of sin. And I'm going to circle back around later and talk about how this relates back to Adam and Eve. Sin with a capital S is our spirit in rebellion against God, the spirit of sin that was placed in us as part of our humanity, inherited or imputed from our human ancestors. And I've got here the plague of sin. The best way, I think, for us to understand sin, it is like a disease, a plague, which our first ancestors contracted. And it's a disease that limited them, that caused them great pain and grief. And it's a disease, like so many diseases of the body, that got passed on to all of their all of the people who came after them. The sin of Adam and Eve got imputed, which means to be credited to or passed on to those who were his descendants. But the point is that sin with a capital S is a characteristic of our fallenness, of our internal fallenness. You know that. Notice so far I haven't said anything about doing anything wrong. Okay. The second understanding is sins with a small s are the acts that we commit which reflect the sinful nature that is in us. Got that? Sin with a capital S, and the only reason I put a capital S on it is so you can differentiate between those two words. Sin is our fallen nature that we inherited from our original ancestors, Adam and Eve, when they defied God and betrayed his confidence and trust. Sins are the acts that we commit because we have sin in our souls, because we have fallen, we are fallen creatures. In other words, we are not sinners because we commit sin. We commit sins because we are sinners. Do you get the difference? Most people think that to be a sinner means you do bad things. That's not what this means. The doctrine of the fall, the theology of the fall and the theology of sin, is that we have fallen, we are fallen inside. We inherited that from our first ancestors who betrayed God. And so therefore we're broken inside. And because we're broken inside, because we are sinners inside, we do bad things, not the other way around. Has everybody got that? Anybody not clear on that one? Because that is the most common misunderstanding people have about the fall and about the nature of sin. They think, I'm a sinner means I do bad things. No, I'm a sinner because I am a fallen creature. And because of that, then I do bad things. That, theologically, is one of the most important aspects of a theological anthropology. Okay, and two scripture verses I'll give you here. One from Psalm 51. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. The idea that we are sinners from birth clearly indicates it's not because of something we did, but rather because of something that is in us, a brokenness that is inherent in us. And from Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? There is something inside me that is broken. And that's what causes me to act in ways I shouldn't. And it's from conception. It's from, you know, before birth, I am a sinner because that is imputed to me. All right? Questions about that?
You don't grow up learning, thinking that.
you don't. You grow up thinking, okay, a sinner is somebody who does something wrong. No, a sinner is everybody. And because of that, we do things wrong.
That's the foundation of legalism. Isn't it not?
What's that?
We are not sinners because we commit sin. We commit, but the other way around, the way she just mentioned that we're brought up,
right,
is kind of the foundation of legalism.
Exactly. The idea that, okay, if you stopped doing bad things, you'd be okay. No. For one thing, being a fallen creature, you're not, you know, a victim of the fall, you're not going to stop doing bad things. Because a bad thing is anything in you which does not express or which is contrary to the nature of God, whether it's an action or not. It could be a wrong motivation. Remember, one of the Ten Commandments is don't covet. It has to do with what you feel, not just what you do. But the idea that the goal is to stop doing bad things, that does not address the basic problem, which is that we have inside us a brokenness, a fallenness, a sinfulness, which has been imputed to us, or that we have inherited from our ancient ancestor Adam. Okay? That's fundamental to an understanding what the fall is and what sin is. And it's not the way most of us think. It's not the way most of us were taught. The idea that most people believe, without ever really thinking about it, that they are basically good. I mean, that's the modern idea. Human beings are basically good, but society causes us to do bad things, or, you know, because we've gotten, you know, our tail's been twisted through life, then we end up acting out. I quoted recently in a sermon, as some of you heard, my old friend Tim Waits, who, when I was in college, after college actually, he was a roommate of ours. He was not a Christian at the time, but he was a searcher. He was a good man, good guy. He was checking out all these different religious groups on college campus, because I'd stayed around college for a while because of the Christian fellowship there. And Tim was going to these different groups, and he finally had visited the Baha'i Fellowship. And coming from that, he sat down with me and he said, you know, all these groups keep telling me the same thing, and that is that I'm good inside, that I'm a good being, that all human beings are good. And we only do bad things because our culture, our environment has caused us to do bad things. And Tim said, you know, I've been thinking about it. If I'm basically good, why is it so hard to be good and so easy to be bad? Well, that's the perfect reasonable observation. If human beings are basically good, then why is evil the most common manifestation almost of human existence? It's you look at it honestly, as Tim did, and I think you see that our natural inclination is to evil. Our heart is deceitful above all things. We were born, from the time our mother conceived us, we are sinners. It's only with the greatest struggle that we do good things. Now, some people are able to do more good things than others, and I think that has to do with that we are still made in the image of God. There is still the flicker inside us somewhere, the flame that represents the fact we are made in God's image, and for some, that is brighter than others. But we are all still sinners. We are all still evil at heart because of the fall. That's a basic Christian doctrine that almost nobody ever talks about, because nobody wants to think that they're basically bad. People don't like that. I want to be good. In fact, I want to not just be good. I want to think of myself as my own little God, which is a New Agey thing that people, well, you are your own little deity. No, I'm not. If I am, if that's true, I'm in trouble. Because my heart is dark, except for the light of redemption, which we're going to get to. Okay? The doctrine... let me do this first, and then I'll talk about the doctrine. Sin began, according to Scripture, with the pride and the fall of Satan. At its core, sin, the doctrine of sin is understood to be selfishness. It's pride. It's wanting my own way. You can be like God, Satan said to Eve, and she thought that sounded good. Just like I can be my own God, right? And there are some religions out there that say, well, if you do the right things, then eventually you'll get your own world to rule, and you'll have your own people, and you'll be your own God over that area. Okay, that's a Mormon belief. Isaiah 14 says, "How you have fallen from heaven, O morning star." This is a scripture about Satan. Satan, who was Lucifer, the angel of light, the most beautiful of all angels, we're told. There is not a lot in Scripture about the devil and his demons. And the reason for that is because God doesn't want us to spend too much energy thinking about or focusing on the devil and the demons. That's not the point of Scripture. As little as we have, people already obsess about it. Can you imagine what people would be doing if there was a lot more information about it? So God intentionally doesn't give us a lot of detail. But we have the Isaiah passage, how you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, which is the ancient name for Venus. The Latin and a name for Venus was Lucifer. Okay, that was an ancient name for the planet Venus. Son of the dawn, you have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the Mount of Assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you are brought down to the grave, to the depths of the pit. It was pride, a desire to be like God, that led to Satan's fall. He was an angel. And elsewhere it says that one-third of the stars were swept from the sky with him. You guys have heard my Billy Graham invitation? Okay. Heard a guy one time imitating Billy Graham, and he said, when Satan fell, he took one-third of the angels with him. You know what that means? We got him outnumbered, 2-1. There's not a lot of detail, but we do have some indications of that. Then Jude 6 and 7 says, and the angels who did not keep their positions of authority but abandoned their own home, these he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains for judgment on the great day. And in 2 Peter 2, 4 and 5, for if God did not spare angels when they sinned but sent them to hell, putting them into gloomy dungeons to be held for judgment, and it goes on. Again, there's not a lot of detail, but the indication is that before humanity fell even, there were angels led by Lucifer, whom we know as Satan or the devil, who chose to challenge the authority of God in order to be greater than they were intended to be. And in doing so, they fell from grace. And that's the motivation, I mean, misery loves company, the motivation for Satan to have tempted Eve, to try to take this highest level, this apex of God's creation, the creature that was made in God's image and was especially loved by God. This is the reason why Satan wanted to tempt Eve to fall with her. People are always, bad people are always trying to get good people to join them. It goes back to Genesis 3. Right? So this is where we saw sin beginning. Sin in terms of angelic sin. Human sin, starting there, human sin then is introduced in Genesis 3. Now, I want to talk about the, go back up and come to this. In terms of a Christian doctrine, the doctrine of the fall really was developed. I told you that the Jews didn't have any doctrine of the fall until the sort of mythological or the Book of Enoch was created a doctrine of the fall in the 2nd century BCE. Irenaeus, which was one of the early church fathers, and Augustine, who lived in the 300s, the bishop of Hippo, the two of them were responsible more than anything else for creating the doctrine of original sin. Original sin being the idea that sin as it exists in us, that idea that we are sinners with a capital S, because we're fallen inside, we have sin in our souls and in our hearts from the point of birth, not because we do things bad. That idea of original sin being inherited or imputed by Adam, or from Adam, really was developed as a doctrine by Irenaeus and Augustine in the very early days of the Christian faith. Then, over a period of time, that got developed, and when we get to the Reformation, we have John Calvin, who is the founder of Reformed theology, on which Presbyterianism is based, and then Martin Luther, of course, one who started the Protestant Reformation. Luther said this about original sin, and the idea here being that original sin not only affected the souls and hearts of all human beings from the point of conception, but that the fall affected all of creation. That original sin led to the fall of everything. As I just said, animals were killed in order to provide skins for Adam and Eve to cover themselves as one of the results of the fall. Well, Martin Luther talks about the pervasiveness of original sin and the fall of creation when he says, And what of thorns, thistles, water, fire, caterpillars, flies, fleas, and bedbugs? Collectively and individually, are not all of them messengers who preach to us concerning sin and God's wrath? All of the evils, all of the, you know, the griefs that occur in the natural world are a part of the fall as well. John Calvin said, that the fall is reflected in the inclemency of the air, in frost, thunder, unseasonable rains, drought, hail, or whatever is disorderly in the world and are the fruits of sin. So creation, the Reformation doctrine of the fall, is that creation fell as well. Now, interesting aspect of that. John Calvin, especially, said that while creation was fallen, we as saved beings have a responsibility to do everything we can to try to keep the fallen creation in some sort of control. We need to do everything we can to try to bring order back to the chaos of this fallen creation. And from Calvin, Francis Bacon and others were greatly influenced, and historians of science will say that the rise of science and technology, especially during the Renaissance period, was significantly because of the doctrine of the fall of creation. That we, as creatures who are redeemed, have a responsibility to try to help fallen creation be less problematic. And so science, technology, so much of that actually grew out of that Christian doctrine. The Christian doctrine of the fall and redemption was the basis for the growth of a lot of science. The idea that we have a responsibility as redeemed creatures to try to bring some order to the fallenness of creation. Right? Fascinating little piece of history. Now, again, we need to recognize that sin is not a product of societal failings. It's not a behavioral acting out because of things that have been done wrong to us, but rather that it is inherited from Adam. In fact, the doctrine of original sin says that in Adam we all fell from grace at that one time. Now here I'm quoting Paul in Romans 5. He writes, "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, that is Adam, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all men, because all sinned, for before the law was given, sin was in the world. But sin is not taken into account when there is no law." Okay, he gets into some of the presence of the law here, but I want to do this whole thing because he mentions three or four times the idea that sin came through Adam and from Adam down to us. "Nevertheless, death reigned from the time of Adam to the time of Moses, even over those who did not sin by breaking a command, as did Adam, who was the pattern of the one to come. But the gift of Jesus Christ's redemption, is not like the trespass. For if many died by the trespasses of one man, Adam, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to many? Again, the gift of God is not the result of the one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. For if by the trespass of the one man," he keeps saying that over and over again, it is the sin, the trespass of Adam that brought sin, original sin, into all of us, "death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ?" Just as Adam was responsible for bringing sin into the world, one man, Adam, one man, Jesus Christ, who was the divine Son of God, can take sin away from the world if we accept Him. Okay? "Consequently, just as the result of one trespass was the condemnation for all men, so also the result of one act of righteousness was justification that brings life for all men. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, the many will be
made righteous.
Sin, the brokenness that is in our soul, the thing that makes us rebellious against God, came down from Adam. It was imputed to us from our most ancient ancestor. Okay? Sierra.
So then, if it's saying that it's through the trespass of just one man, does that mean then if Eve would have taken it and offered it to Adam, the fruit, if he
wouldn't have taken it, then that's what hers wouldn't have been considered the trespass?
Well, that would have been an interesting question. We might have ended up with two very different camps in the created world. I don't have an answer for that. As I say, Adam, who was created first, the man was held more responsible than Eve. The interpretations people make that Eve is held to blame, that Eve is somehow, the bad guy or bad girl in all this, is not scripturally accurate. What would have happened if Eve ate the apple and Adam didn't? I can only guess. I don't know. I don't have an idea about that. Bob, first.
Is this verse 18, I think, the verse that starts with consequently?
Right.
Does that indicate universal salvation?
No. It brings life for all men who would accept it. It's not universalism. It does say one act of right. The question was asked at the start of the break, well, if it was the decision by Adam and Eve that caused sin to come into the world, then why did Adam and Eve make the bad choice if sin wasn't in the world yet? Well, you get into the nature of free will with that one, which obviously we can have a whole class on the issue of free will. But basically, when God created Adam and Eve, because he created them for fellowship, and that was only possible if they could choose to have a relationship with God. Someone who is forced to have a relationship, someone who is forced to love someone else, it's not really love. It's not really fellowship. So when God created the world, God did not create evil. God did not create sin. But he created a world where his creatures, both the angels and humanity, could choose to love, could choose to be in a relationship. Well, by definition, if they had the power to choose to do that in order for it to be real love and real fellowship, then they had the power to choose not to. Adam and Eve, there was no sin in the world, there was no evil in the world, but they had the free choice. And so at that point in which they had the choice to make, they chose wrongly. And it was from that wrong choice, which was based upon a good thing. Free choice was a good thing that God gave. It was a blessing. Because of a wrong choice, then evil came into the world, and sin came into the world, and its sin was imputed to all the rest of creation. Because Adam, when we talked about this, Adam was the federal head, to use the expression. And there's two aspects to that. One, in terms of humanity, Adam was our progenitor. He was our first ancestor. And so, as I described it, in the same way that disease can be passed down, fallenness, original sin, was a plague that got passed down. And so in that regard, we understand that as being something that then infected all humanity. But there's another aspect, too, that it's difficult for us to sort of conceive of being Adam and Eve, and that is Adam was responsible, not Eve, and that's why Adam was held responsible by God. Because Adam was the apex of creation, and God had already said, you name the animals, because they're your responsibility. You take care of the garden, because creation is your responsibility. As the federal head over all creation, the one that had been appointed, that when Adam fell, the consequences of that fell on everyone else. An imperfect, but perhaps helpful analogy would be, if a president or a prime minister declares war against another country, who is it that suffers the consequences? All of the people, okay? The people who themselves may not have been involved in that particular choice, or who may not even have wanted for there to be war. That's not a commentary on war, by the way. But the idea is that we have, as a standard concept in human society, the idea that there are people who are federal heads who, when they make decision, the consequences are passed on to everybody else. That's very much the case with Adam. He was not only the physical progenitor of all humanity, but he was the federal head, the one responsible for all of creation. So all of creation was affected when he made the wrong choice.
And God said to Adam, don't eat the tree, not say to Eve.
He did. That's exactly why Adam is held more responsible than Eve, because God spoke directly to Adam. Adam passed it on to Eve. Eve got tempted by Satan, by the snake. To some extent, you could say, well, Eve was deciding between whether to listen to her husband Adam or whether to listen to the devil, and she chose the devil. Adam was deciding, do I listen to Eve or do I listen to God? And he chose Eve. So the choice that Eve made was between her husband and the devil. That even though she knew that it had come from God, still it was her husband's word on this. Whereas Adam chose his wife's recommendation over what he knew God had said because he heard it firsthand. And that's why Adam, too, is held more responsible. Okay? John?
I have a comment, and help me with this. You mentioned earlier that God put us a level upon us that was unattainable. He placed upon us this perfection that,
right,
that we could never attain. Would it be more accurate to describe, to say that, you know, because you hear that and you think God was capricious and he just decided to make an impossible standard for us, who some theologians and some people today in the contemporary church point their finger at God accusingly, saying, yeah, you've given us a standard, and Paul addressed that in Romans, you've given us a standard we cannot attain. Would it be more accurate maybe to say that he never did that because he is the standard? And we drove away from that through Adam's and Eve's sin.
Right.
The standard was never imposed upon us as a capricious, secondary, thoughtful thing. He is the standard of perfection, and he made man in such a way to have this communion with him, but man chose to sin. And so that was breached. And that standard is now unobtainable. But he didn't just place it upon us as being some, you know, impossible, you know.
Well, both of those things are true. It's not either or. Because God is perfect. God made a creation that was perfect. And free will was part of the perfection of that. The fact that love could exist, that fellowship could exist, willingly. And God made... God was perfect. He made a creation that was perfect. We made the wrong choice. We being humanity, represented by our ancient ancestors. And so, went away from that. God being perfect does not... I've talked a lot in this class about, and in the survey class, about the accommodation of God. That God has stooped to us in communicating. That he has spoken in language that we understand. That he has interacted in history in a way that we can understand. That God has accommodated himself to us. There is one way in which God has not accommodated himself to us, and that is he has not either himself become less perfect so that we could relate to him, nor has he compromised the standard of perfection which he represents. And so in that regard, by not doing so, God has made the standard. Now it existed by his nature. It is by the nature of God that perfection is the standard. But the fact that it's unattainable... If we did not have a sense in which God's standard was unattainable, then we would diminish the sacrifice of Christ.
Oh, certainly, but the point I'm making is that there are people today that are preaching that say, that are pointing an accusative finger at God, saying, well, he's a God of love. He would never do that.
Yeah.
You know, and what I see is we left his perfection.
Yeah.
We chose to leave it. We chose to abandon it.
Right.
And of course, that's all the more reason why we need Christ in
right.
our lives.
But I think that's true. I think the fact that God has not compromised, he's not said, okay,
right.
that's good enough.
Right, exactly.
Is why no human effort, no right. effort by any man or woman, is sufficient to meet the perfect standard of God. Only the sacrifice of the one who was perfect, the one who was without sin, the one who himself did not deserve punishment, took punishment upon himself. And so if we ever start talking in terms of diminishing the perfection of God or the perfect standard that God wants us to achieve, be perfect even as, you know, as your Father in heaven is perfect, if we try to water that down, then we water down the significance of the sacrifice of Christ, that he was the only one that could do it. And we start, then we get into that theology of works, that I can make myself better by being better. And I can't. I can never get there. All right? Compared to a perfect God, how good is good enough? Perfect. Right? That's the standard.
Did I sound like I was?
No,
because I'm not. He is absolutely flawless.
I didn't get a sense of that, and I know where you're coming from on it, but it really is both and. I mean, because God is perfect, he made a creation which is perfect, a standard which is perfect. When we went away from it, God then very specifically has kept that as the standard. He has established and said...
Yeah, he's not going to flick. He's not flexible.
And Jesus said about the law, for instance, which was given, that if you have, unless you have done everything, every jot and tittle of the law, then you have failed, as though you violated it all, because it's perfection is what God established. But then we can't be accusatory toward God and say he has not been fair, he's not been gracious, because he paid that price himself.
Exactly.
He made perfection
exactly.
available to us. I mean, how generous can you get? You don't compromise the standard, you provide for that standard to be met
exactly.
by your own sacrifice. Okay. All right, I want to talk for a few minutes about sin in Judaism and how they understand what sin is all about. The Jewish conception of sin is very much what I was talking about earlier. The Greek word hamartia, which means to miss the mark, which is the most common word that's translated sin in our English Bibles. Like you're shooting, you know, a bow. And the Jews use this as well, because the Hebrew word chait is basically the same meaning, to hit the mark, or to miss the mark, rather. To miss the mark, to not be accurate. The interesting thing is that to the Jews, the idea of missing the target, chait or sin, they believe that the Torah, the law, gives you ways in which your arrow will be more accurate. And in fact, according to traditional Jewish theology, the Jews see the Torah as 613 different ways in which their arrow can be made straighter to hit the mark. Every law is seen as one more way in which the arrow can be more accurate in trying to hit the mark that God has established. All right? So that's how they interpret the law, as being trying to help them hit that mark, that chait, the missing the mark, sin is all about. In fact, Jews believe that the task of Gentiles, non-Jewish people, is to fulfill the seven Noahic laws. Noah was given seven commandments that involved don't commit blasphemy or idolatry, don't commit murder, don't steal, some of the things that we see in the Ten Commandments. Establish a law, a set of laws. These were the commandments that were given to Noah before the law was given to Moses. Well, the traditional Jews believe that the job of Gentiles is to follow those seven rules, and that those seven rules can help them hit the mark. But interestingly enough, traditionally the Jews say, well, because they look at the Torah, the law, and they have 613 rules to help them hit the mark, and we only have seven, that we are far less likely to hit the mark than they are, okay? Because we only have seven things to help us, you know, get in the right point, and they have 613, which I think is fascinating. But they do believe, see, the traditional Jewish view is not that all Jews are blessed and will be saved and Gentiles will not. They think that righteous Gentiles can also satisfy the expectation of God if we obey the Noahic law, because Noah was before Abraham, and Noah, therefore, represents all humanity. And that's why those rules are for us, but the Mosaic law was given after the Hebrew people were created, and so those laws are just for the Jews. All right? Now, give you a little bit of a sense of how the Jews feel about how they don't have the same sense of redemption, meaning to be spiritually saved, because they don't have the same sense in which our spirits are fallen. They don't have a concept of original sin the same way we do. They've not interpreted that way. But they believe that the goal of the life for the Jew is to obey the laws of the Torah, to get closer to hitting the mark, which means leading a good life on earth, improving this world, and by doing so, we will accelerate the point at which God brings the Jews back from exile, that God recreates the Garden of Eden, in effect. So the Jews believe, as we are obedient to the Torah, everything we do is a positive step toward eventually getting righteous enough as a people, the Jewish people, to get righteous enough where God will fulfill his ultimate promise, which is to bring the Jews back from exile, to recreate the promised land, in effect to make it into the Garden of Eden as originally was intended, to rebuild the temple and reestablish his personal relationship and communion with the Jewish people. Okay, so that's why Judaism is much more works-oriented, because they deal with the here and now. They have a concept in which that redemption means historically to be brought back from exile. As I mentioned that earlier. God does not redeem from sin in the sense of spiritually saving us, but rather brings back from exile. We have Adam and Eve being exiled. We have the most obvious examples were the fact that the Jews were in exile in Egypt under slavery, And so after the Mosaic Covenant, God is always described as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who brought our people up out of slavery in Egypt, who brought us back from exile. Then when the Jews were under the Babylonian exile, you know, they were taken captive and taken off into Babylon, and we have all the prophecies about returning from exile, and they were returned and rebuilt the temple after the Persians defeated the Babylonians. And they, under Zerubbabel the governor, Ezra and Nehemiah, rebuilt the temple and rebuilt the city. Then the Romans came in AD 70, I mean they were controlling it, in AD 70 they destroyed the temple and destroyed the city of Jerusalem, and there was a new diaspora. Diaspora means spreading out. Again, this occurred, the Jews were sent into exile, well, they began to return in the 1940s. So that was almost 2,000 years of exile, as they see it. And as I mentioned in one of the earlier classes, more and more and more Jews are returning to the Holy Land. Right now, more than a third of all Jews in the world live in Israel. That's, there are more Jews living in Israel now than any, in the cities in Israel, than any other single place. More Jews in Israel than any other single place. They're, the two-thirds that are scattered around the world are in smaller pockets. The expectation is that by the year 2020, which is only 8 years from now, there will be more Jews inside Israel than outside Israel, which is a phenomenon that would never have been believed just 10 years ago. Nobody who deals in demographics or international distribution of population thought that could be possible. And yet, they see that as a return from exile. Ultimately, the Jews see the final return from exile as being the ultimate redemption. And again, we're talking about redemption here. To the Jews, redemption means being brought back from exile by God. Ezekiel 36 says, "For I will take you," that is the Jews, "out of the nations, I will gather you from all the countries and bring you back into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. You will live in the land I gave your forefathers. You will be my people and I will be your God." There's that promise again. "I will save you from all your uncleanness." This is what redemption means to the Jews. They were redeemed when they were brought out of slavery in Egypt. They were redeemed when Cyrus, let the Persian king, let them return from Babylon to the Holy Land. There was a redemption occurring and continuing when the Jews began to return to the Holy Land in the 40s. And this is a prophecy about the ultimate redemption, which the Jews expect will occur. John?
Question. So do they look at redemption more from a community, national perspective than we as Christians look at redemption on an individual?
Absolutely. The Christian idea of redemption is that it's an individual thing, that I'm saved or redeemed individually as I accept the act of the Redeemer, who is Jesus Christ. And that's a thing that will happen in eternity. At the final consummation is when my redemption will ultimately be made complete. I accept it now, as I accept Jesus Christ, but it will be made complete when I stand before the great white throne and hear, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant," because of my faith in Jesus. That's the point at which my redemption takes hold. The Jews, however, do believe that it's not an individual thing, it's a corporate thing. It is for the people of Israel. And they believe that it is a historical redemption, and always has been. Redemption has occurred several times for them. The ultimate redemption is this one, but it will occur at a time in history rather than at the end of history as we know it, which is the basic Christian belief. Okay, so there is a significant difference there. It is a national liberation the Jews, the traditional Jewish belief is that since this is a time of perfection, the thing that will hurry or will hasten the occurrence of that final redemption is for the Jewish people to make the world a more righteous place. Because the more righteous they make it, the more ready God is going to be to bring them all back out of exile. And so every act is seen, every positive act, every act in fulfillment of the Torah, of generosity, of compassion, all of these things, are seen as a way of moving forward toward the final redemption, which is a historical redemption for the whole people of Israel. Questions about that? Yes, Bill.
So they still just ignore the verses of Scripture in the Old Testament which refer to Jesus?
Well, they don't refer to Jesus, they refer to the Messiah.
Of course.
We need to be clear. They believe that one aspect of the eventual return will be that the Scion of David, that is, the heir to David's throne, if you look in Isaiah 9, the great unto us a child is born, unto us, you know, that goes on to say, and you know, that there will be a leader who will sit on the throne of David and reestablish it. So they see all of those messianic interpretation, messianic verses that we see as being part of this national redemption, this calling of the Hebrew people out of exile, of reestablishing the homeland and giving them a king who is heir to the throne of David that was promised. You know, David was promised that there would always be someone who would sit on his throne. Well, Jesus was an heir to David. You know, Jesus was of the tribe of Judah and the house of David. And so we see him as a fulfillment of all that as well. They don't perceive it that way. The Jews have a very different interpretation. Because this is Old Testament theology, we have to have some sense of how the Jews see it based on entirely the Old Testament. We have the fulfillment of that in understanding Jesus as being the son of David, who is the king, who is God, who is our Redeemer, who paid the price for our sins.
Including Isaiah 53, which is really...
Right, Isaiah is full of more of those messianic prophecies, or Davidic prophecies, if you want to call it that, the fulfillment of the line of David, than any other single book. But you find them in Jeremiah, in Malachi, in Ezekiel, in the Psalms. You know, there are many, many different references to that. All those verses, as I said in church, that we use at Christmas time to talk about the promise of the coming of Jesus. Now, it's interesting, too, to know that when we talk about original sin and fall and redemption, there are other ancient Near Eastern stories about fall, about the fall. There's a Zoroastrian, which is Persian. Zoroastrianism was one of the religions of Persia, that talks about Yima, who was the first man who committed a sin, was cast out of paradise, and was given over to the power of the serpent who would bring about his death. We also have a story from that same, from the Mesopotamian region, of two, the first pair, man and woman, Masha and Mashyana, who were introduced as being righteous, but then they violated the rules by eating forbidden fruit at the instigation of a lying spirit, and they were cast out of paradise. And again, some people would say, some liberal scholars will say, well, the Genesis story is just copied. Perhaps it's more that, you know, Jung, if you guys have studied psychology at all, Jung talks about the cosmic unconscious, that there seems to be kind of archetypal realities that different people in different places and different cultures share. And it may very well be that the reason why we have ancient cultures who share very similar myths is because something really happened. And they have, you know, varying stories that are amazingly accurate in terms of being similar to one another. Slightly different, different names, slightly different, but astonishingly, the same thing with the creation accounts and with the account of the deluge, the great flood. All three of those, you know, the creation, the fall, and the deluge, we have ancient cultures who have very similar stories on those. And to my mind, it sounds to me like something really might have happened, and that they all have accounts of slightly different, as it's been passed down through history, but very similar, okay? Now, I want to talk a little bit about redemption from our perspective. Again, the Jewish perspective is that redemption, in fact, the Hebrew word for redemption, I should say, is padah, which means to deliver, or to sever, as in severing from slavery. And so the Jewish idea of being delivered from slavery, of being delivered from oppression, of being delivered back from exile into the garden is the expectation. With the Messiah, who's the heir to David, with the temple being rebuilt, the Holy Land being theirs again. Redemption then, from a Christian point of view, has all of that. And we, in fact, our doctrine of redemption is based upon a lot of the Old Testament verses as well. Exodus 6:6 says, "Wherefore say unto the children of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burden of the Egyptians. I will rid you out of their bondage. I will redeem you with a stretched out arm and with great judgments." A lot of the Old Testament verses like that one are verses in which we hear God promising that He will bring us out from under oppression. that he will bring us out from under bondage. And with our understanding of the doctrine of original sin, we understand the oppression and the bondage is the spiritual oppression, the spiritual bondage that we have inherited because of the imputation of sin from our ancestor Adam. Those are all the verses that Paul is using where he says, as sin came into the world through one man's decision, Adam's decision. So we read all of the verses like that as an indication that God will redeem us, but not from a physical exile, from a national exile, from a geopolitical exile, but rather from an exile from the presence of God because of the fallenness that's in our heart, the sinfulness that's in our heart. So redemption for us, alongside doctrines of reconciliation and propitiation or atonement, where Jesus paid the price for us, these are keys to our overall sense of what salvation is. And particularly, to be redeemed means to be bought. You are paid for with a price, Scripture says. When you redeem something, you go to a pawn shop and you redeem it, you pay the price in order to get it out. That's what redemption means for us. For the Hebrew people, redemption means that each of us does our own little bit of righteousness, and eventually that righteousness will add up enough to let God let us come back from exile. But that's a works righteousness. And our theology is very clear that we cannot achieve righteousness by our own efforts. So the Christian view of it is that the price to redeem us, to get us out of bondage, to get us out, to deliver us from the oppression that we experience, the price was paid by the only one who could pay the price, who is Jesus Christ. Now, in fact, the word that we translate as redemption is the Greek word in the New Testament, is lutrio, which comes from the luo, which means to loose. Lutrio is the ransom price. It's used that way to pay, to get someone out. Hosea, in the Old Testament, Hosea is married to Gomer, who's a prostitute and unfaithful. And God tells Hosea to go and get Gomer, bring her back. She's a symbol for the unfaithfulness of Israel. And he goes and he pays the ransom price, because apparently she got herself in such trouble that she was in indentured servitude and had to be bought. So he paid a price to bring her back. Well, that's the in the Septuagint, the word for that is the same word that we translate as ransom price or lutrio in the Greek New Testament. The releasing by the payment of a price. Again, because we're talking about Old Testament, I want to talk a little bit more about what all is included in the Jewish eschatology. You know the word eschatology? And eschaton in Greek means the last things. Eschatology is the study of the last things. For the Jewish people who believe in a literal return from exile as a blessing by God, it includes all of the following, and this is where you get some of the messianic stuff. The Jews believe that God will redeem Israel, pay the price to get them out of captivity, whatever that price is. That they in some way will redeem them from exile. He did it in exile in Egypt. He did it in exile in Babylon. He did it from the exile after AD 70 when the Romans destroyed Jerusalem and the people started returning. So the idea is that ultimately God will redeem all of Israel and bring them back from exile. So that the second point is he returns all of the Jews, all of them, to the land of Israel and resettles them in the promised land. Obviously there are all kinds of political questions we have about how that's going to work, but this is the belief that the traditional Jewish folks have. And as I said earlier, taken as a whole, the Jewish people are a very secular people now. The majority of them do not have, if you talk about the Messiah to most Jews today, they go, yeah, right, that's a wonderful story, it's a wonderful fable. They don't have any real sense of that. They would see their Jewishness, if it's going to be manifested in any way, through a Zionistic, you know, a idea of having a homeland for the Jews. But very practical, very here and now, very, you know, there's very little spirituality in it. A lot of Jewish people today are at best agnostic, and many of them are atheistic, okay, which is unfortunate. So a third aspect, so first God will redeem Israel, he will return the Jews to the Holy Land. The third is he will restore the house of David and the temple as a place of worship. So this idea of restoration. The house of David will be restored by the promise. The temple will be rebuilt again. Now you do understand the temple has been rebuilt twice before. It was the original temple, which was Solomon's temple. And then that was destroyed with the Babylonian destruction in 586. Then they returned from Persia later that same century, and they rebuilt the temple under Zerubbabel, Ezra, and Nehemiah. And then that's the temple, which Herod really fixed up. In fact, it's interesting if you read Haggai and some of the other writers at that time, that when they rebuilt the temple the second time, the second temple in the 500s, they were grieving over the fact that it was so much less than the original temple. It was smaller, it wasn't as pretty, it didn't have as much gold. You know, and they go on and on about how embarrassing it is that their new temple is so much worse than the original one had been, the Solomon's temple. But then Herod came along, and one of the things he did to show his authority, and this is prior to the time of Jesus, is he really tripped out the temple so that it achieved some of its earlier glory. And that was the temple then that the Romans destroyed in AD 70, all of which now exists, all that exists now of that temple, the second temple, is the Western Wall, which is the Wailing Wall, these huge blocks which you see the Jews standing in front of and praying, doing this thing. And the problem that they have is that right now, on the Temple Mount, it's called, there are two Islamic mosques. There is the Dome of the Rock, which is the big golden dome you see in all the pictures of Jerusalem. And then, just south of that, there's a much smaller church, which is the Al-Aqsa Mosque, which has a silver dome. People often don't even notice it because it's so much smaller and not nearly as obvious as the gold on the Dome of the Al-Aqsa. Well, the Jews today who are looking forward to the reestablishing of the temple say that God may send a natural disaster to destroy those, because they can't go in and just tear this mosque down. That would violate, you know, the law as they understand it. They're not supposed to do that, but they think God will do that so that they can reestablish the temple and the temple worship. There is even a sect of Jews today that are preparing all of the materials, all of the implements and things to try to reinstitute the sacrificial system. Not a big group, but there's a small sect that are doing that because they want to get back to the place they believe where they're obedient to the Old Testament law, which involves sacrificing animals. So, God will redeem Israel. God will return all the Jews to the land of Israel. God will restore the house of David and the temple. Fourth, God will establish a regent from the house of David, whom we call the Messiah, a ruler who will be from the house of David, who will again lead the people and usher in a new age of justice and peace and good government. Right? That's the Messiah as we understand it. So they interpret all of those passages in Isaiah and Jeremiah and the Psalms, the Messianic passages, as being the promise of that regent from the line of David who will be the government head, who will bring us in this age of peace. They also believe that all nations at that point will recognize the God of Israel as the only true God. Because you will remember, as we've talked about, like during the covenant time, when we talk about the covenants, the Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all of them, we're told that when God established the covenant with Abraham and then reaffirmed it with his son and grandson, he said, "And through you I will bless all nations of the earth." And Scripture says that all people will look to the God of Israel and recognize him as the one true God. So the Jews believe that will be another aspect of the redemption, the end time. They believe that as part of that, God will resurrect the dead and create a new heaven and a new earth. The promise that God will make all things new again. That same promise is restated in Revelation in our New Testament, but it's an Old Testament concept as well. So all of this, the Jews believe, will occur in history, will be completed in real time, not when the world as we know it comes to an end and we are before the throne of grace, but rather that it will be a historical event that will occur. The Jews maintain belief in, if you're familiar with Maimonides, you ever heard of Maimonides? He was one of the greatest of all Jewish rabbis. He was also called the Rambam. You may see that sometime, R-A-M-B-A-M. His name was Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon. So Maimonides was what he was called. He's from the 12th century. He was a rabbi, a philosopher, a physician and healer, and also a community leader. He established the 13 basic principles of Judaism, which Jews, conservative Jews, practicing Jews, religious Jews, look to today as being the basics of their faith. They believe in the existence of a creator, in God's absolute and unparalleled unity, which of course they believe is violated by our belief in the Trinity. They believe in God's non-corporeality. He doesn't have a body. They believe in God's eternity. They believe in that they are to worship God exclusively with no other gods. They believe that God communicates with humanity through prophets and prophecy. The belief in the primacy of Moses' prophecy as the teacher. The belief in the divine origin of the Torah, the first five books of Moses, the law, the instruction. Belief in the immutability of the Torah. It can't be changed. Belief in God's omniscience and providence. And then the last three, the reason I'm mentioning these here, the last three of Maimonides' 13 principles are belief in divine reward and retribution. They do believe in Judaism that reward will come. It will come in this world, in this life, but that evil people will be destroyed. So that's number 11, belief in divine reward and retribution. 12, a belief in the arrival of the Messiah and the Messianic era. The regent, as I called him a minute ago, who is of the line of David, who will be the new king, who will lead them into a period of peace and justice. And then the 13th is the belief in the resurrection of the dead, that the dead will rise, and that all Jews, according to this is the Jewish belief, all Jews will be resurrected and will exist in this new fulfillment of the promised land, that in effect death is a kind of exile, and that it will be undone, and that the Jews that have always, the Jews that have lived in the past, will all be called back together in this new redemptive history. As God brings them back into the Holy Land. There obviously are parallels between that and our concept of redemption. For us, a different understanding of what redemption means comes from the New Testament. And remember that, with the exception of Luke, all of the New Testament writers, especially Paul, from whom most of our theology of this comes from, was himself Jewish. That's where we get a full understanding of original sin, where we get a full understanding of God's spiritual redemption, of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ as being the Redeemer for us who paid the price. Without the New Testament, there is a less refined understanding of that in the Jewish system. Questions about any of that? The fall and redemption. Judy?
Do they mean that the dead will be raised before the end of the world?
They don't believe the world will end in the way we understand it to end. They believe that this is going to happen in history. See, our conception is that the world as we know it will end, and there will be the time of a new heaven and a new earth. Well, I actually do believe God is going to remake everything, but they see it as sort of a reordering and cleaning up and making better. But they believe that God's going to do it now, just like they believe redemption has happened before, not the final redemption, which is different. But that acts of redemption have happened before, and they've been historical events for the Jewish people. That it will be similar to that, except more complete, and will involve, amongst those complete things, a resurrection from the dead. Now, not all Jews agree with that, by the way. Not all people, that's one of the points of Maimonides that not everyone would agree with. Jews have not always, there have been groups of Jews, like the Sadducees, did not believe in the resurrection of the body. That's one of the arguments that was happening in Jesus' time between the Pharisees, who were the fundamentalists of their day, they were the strict believers in all of the law and the prophets, and the Sadducees, who only believed or held authority in the first five books, the Torah, the books of Moses. They did not look at any of the rest of what we call the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, as being authoritative for them. And so they had doctrinal differences. The Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. Physical resurrection. They believe in the eternity of the soul, but not physical resurrection. And it's helpful to understand that because you get cases like it was a Sadducee who came to Jesus and said, all right, in obedience to the law, a man and a woman are married, and he dies. Well, the law says that his brother should marry her and bear children in his name. So the woman marries his brother, and he dies. So she marries the second brother. He dies, third brother, until she's married seven brothers. And the Sadducee who's asking the question says, so, at the time of the resurrection, which one's going to be married to her? Well, the reason he asked that question is because he doesn't believe in the resurrection, and he thinks he's catching Jesus in a conundrum that he's either going to have to deny the resurrection, which is what they believe, or he's going to have to come up with some excuse for how seven people can be married to one woman, which there wasn't polygamy in that. Jesus does neither one. He says, you just don't get it, do you? In fact, he says that. You don't get it, do you? You really haven't studied this stuff the way you should have. that there will be neither marriage nor giving in marriage in the kingdom. And some people go, well, I want to be married. I like my wife. Well, the point is, I believe Jesus goes on to make the point that in heaven, in the final day, all relationships are going to be completely open and completely fulfilling. That our relationship with our spouse is not going to be less, it's going to be more. And we're not going to worry, we're not going to have this concept of I have a special relationship with only one person, but rather that we, in the presence of God, are going to have a fulfilling relationship with everybody. We may still have a special relationship with that one person, but it's not going to be marriage in the way we conceive of marriage. That's not going to be necessary. Okay. So Jesus didn't answer the way they thought, but my point in that is, if you understand that the Sadducees were one party who did not believe in the resurrection of the dead, Maimonides in the 12th century insisted that's a basic principle of Judaism. Today, there are some Jews who don't believe in the resurrection of the dead. For that matter, there are some Jews who don't believe in God. But that this still is seen as one of the fulfillments, the redemptive act that God is going to do for the Jewish people, based upon their reading of the Old Testament, without the further filling out that we get from the New Testament explanations. Other questions?
I got one.
Sure.
This thing about national redemption and the Jews, the way they see that, is there a connection with, in Romans 11, Paul talks about, and in the way all Israel will be saved, and it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion, and he predicts this salvation of all of Israel.
That is a New Testament prediction too, by the way, as John is pointing out, that all Israel will be saved. That's in the New Testament. Right. Yeah.
Is that connected to this idea of national redemption? Was he speaking from his Pharisaical? No, I know he was speaking inspired.
Yeah.
Inspired, but what I'm wondering is there a connection between what he says here and this redemptive, this national redemption?
It could be. Clear affirmative answer on that, because the Jews perceived themselves, they didn't have this idea of individuality and personal spiritual commitment the way that we do. They thought each person had a responsibility, but what they were doing when they did acts of righteousness was they were contributing to the larger whole, which was the point. It may very well be that when Paul is writing about that he's reflecting that consideration in the Jewish people, that they thought much more in terms of a corporate kind of salvation. It says that all Jews will return to the promised land, and that it says all will be saved. We don't know how that works. Our belief is that it means that all will come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, because salvation is only to be found in Him, we know. But that there will be a great revival amongst the Jewish people where they come to a knowledge of Jesus as the fulfillment of the Messiah. That's part of the process. Beyond that, I don't know.
It could be supporting
the idea of
a national redemption, which they see in a shadow. They see in a cloud. But maybe Paul is reflecting something far more accurate.
Yeah, the description that I just gave you for what the Jewish conception of the time of redemption is going to be, that eschatology, is not any different than what we see. The only real difference is how we get there. But when you read the description that I just gave you, the idea that God is going to redeem Israel from exile and captivity, return the Jews to the land of Israel, restore the house of David, create a regent from the house of David, have all people recognize the God of Israel as the one true God, resurrect the dead, create a new heaven and a new earth, that's all part of our belief. The difference we have is how we get there. They believe that it is everyone has a responsibility to do small acts of righteousness, and the cumulative effect will mean at some point we get righteous enough as a whole that God decides to bring us to the time of redemption. We believe that the act of redemption has been done, price has been paid by a redeemer, and that it is just a matter of time. Scripture says the reason that God delays is out of grace, because He wants to give more people an opportunity to hear and believe. So how we get there, the Jewish conception and our conception is different, but if you start lining up what we perceive it's going to look like, there really aren't significant differences. Now, there's a lot of mystery in there, a lot of things we don't know about it, but that much we do know. Other questions or comments? Bill?
When Jesus said the generations that sees the budding of the fig tree won't pass away until... Would you comment on that? Because this is what we're talking about.
I'd have to look at that. The generation that sees the budding of the fig tree will not pass away. I don't know. I think it's, you know, Jesus was speaking figuratively or metaphorically there, because obviously everyone who was alive when he was alive is dead now. So, you know, Jesus also said, not all of you will taste of death before I return. And the early church thought that meant Jesus was going to come back like right now.
Yeah.
That didn't prove to be the case. Now, so there are some different interpretations of what that meant. I don't really feel like I comment on it without thinking about it a little bit more. Sorry.
That's fine.
You know, Carolyn's sister said that, you know, wrote to her and said that they'd had a game of stump the preacher in their church, and that she'd ask a question that the preacher couldn't answer. And I said, the very idea of having a stump the preacher event strikes me as being very unwise. It's hard enough the way it is. Any last questions? I appreciate it. My apologies for being late to get that stuff up and then having the wrong stuff up. I think the correct one is up now. I fixed it at the break. So let me close in prayer. We are grateful again, Father, for your grace. Give us a heart that looks toward your redemptive act in history, as well as your redemptive act at the end of all things. And most of all, make us aware that the only redemption that can occur is through the redemption of your Son, Jesus, who paid the price for us. That it is He who calls us out of slavery to sin and to oppression from our own nature. And that we love you for that and for the grace you've given us in it. Teach us to grow in that and to love you more all the time as we look forward to that great day. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Homer.
Homer.